هاتوا هاتوا هاتوا. اقفل كل الطرق بسرعة. ماشي؟ اسمع الكلام. ماشي.
عجل سيدي.
عجل. السلام عليكم يا شيخ.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام.
تفضل لقدام.
Coffee?
Yeah, thank you.
How have you liked your stay?
What I've seen, I've liked.
Cut down.
Please to explain why I should agree to interview with pro-Zionist American media.
Because I think Hezbollah is trying to broaden into a political party right now. So you care about what you're thought of in America. And in America, at this moment in time, Hezbollah does not have a face. That's why.
Perhaps you prove journalism objectivity, and I see the questions first. Then I decide if I grant the interview.
No, we don't do that. You've seen 60 Minutes and Mike Wallace, so you know our reputation for integrity and objectivity. You also know we are the highest rated, most respected TV magazine news show in America. So, Mr. Wallace, should he get on a plane or not?
Tell him I will see him day after tomorrow.
That's good, that works. You know, I wanted to ask you something. I know it sounds odd, but hello, Sheikh? Hello, Sheikh? Norman!
What? What?
Take your blindfold off. Welcome to the world.
Fluctuating all over the place. Anywhere we shoot here, it's gonna be portable jennies and we'll run cable.
Mike, it's me. We're on.
What's new?
Miss Loffer gave me a star today.
Yeah? What for?
For reading.
It's great. A little early for cartoons, isn't it?
You are home. It's early, isn't it? Oh, I'm gonna take Debbie to ballet.
Come on.
She's playing with my poodle again.
Slow down. Breathe deep. Slow down. Here we go. Deep breaths.
She's playing with the poodle.
Who's dusty, sweetheart? It's dusty and you breathed him in. Okay? So what's happening to you now is cells called mast cells. Told your lungs, don't breathe any more of that dust in. The airways in your lungs are like branches. When the branches close up, you get an asthmatic attack. And we give you medicine and you get better. Uh-huh. Okay. Better already, aren't you? Okay, baby.
Can I go to dance tomorrow? I'm better.
If you are, then I'll take Barbara to soccer and take you to dance after.
I can take her.
Don't you have to be at the office?
Is there any more rice?
Yes, it's on the stove. Do you want more rice?
Maybe later.
How about you?
I'll take some.
Instant rice?
Can I go over to Janine's house?
I'm sorry, darling. Have you seen my coffee mug?
Try the car.
What are those boxes?
I'm going to the store. You need anything?
What do you need at the store?
Soy sauce.
Right now?
That's my stuff from the office.
Well, why did you take your stuff from the office?
I didn't want to leave it there.
I don't understand.
I got fired this morning. Where else am I going to take it?
Why? Who said?
Thomas Sandifer.
What are we supposed to do? What about our medical coverage? What about our health? What about our car payments? Our payments on this house?
As a severance agreement includes cash payouts over time, continuing medical coverage. Sure you don't need anything?
No, thank you.
Pleased to receive you as my guest, Mr. Wallace.
Thank you for having us.
I think I've got a problem with the jetty. I've got to go outside.
Yeah. Give me a hand with this one.
Norman!
Norman! He says you must not sit so close.
What? I can't conduct an interview from back there.
You must move back your chair.
Well, you tell him that when I conduct an interview, I sit anywhere I damn please.
There is no interview.
You! I'm talking to you.
What
the hell do you think I am, a 78-year-old assassin? You think I'm going to karate him to death with this notepad?
Are you interpreting
what I'm saying?
Yes.
We're there.
Good. Well, ask him if Arabic is his second language.
Hold it.
Slow. Shake.
Do you mind if you would just turn your chair a little bit to face Mr. Wallace?
Is
that okay?
Okay.
Are you ready, or do you want to keep fucking around and warm up some more?
No. I've got my heart started.
Okay. All right, Todd. Give me the three button on mic, please. Okay, we are rolling. Okay, Mike.
Sheikh Fadlala, thank you so much for seeing us. Are you a terrorist?
Mr. Wallace, I am a servant of God.
A servant of God? Really? Americans believe that you, as an Islamic fundamentalist, that you are a leader who contributed to the bombing of the U.S. Embassy.
Now, everybody thinks Canadian Mounties ride horses and rescue ladies from rapids. Mike, they backed locals in Oka in a fight with Mohawks over building a golf course on their burial site. They beat up protesters at Kenosaki. Did you hear that?
Hello.
Oh, someone took a poll. Are all things Canadian boring?
It's Stuart. He's in Mexico City.
Oh, let me play that. You asked him. What do New York think?
Hey, Dad.
Will he go on camera and talk about the Mexico City branch?
Sure. Hey, Jake.
Whose money are they loaning?
No classes this morning?
I don't have to be there till 10:30.
Yeah.
Hey, Mom.
Hello. Hey, sweetheart. Hello?
Will independent sources corroborate?
Yeah.
Dad, you got a box out here.
I know, because I got to know where you're going at all times.
I can't. I've got to fly to Boston tomorrow. 2 p.m. Great. Bye-bye.
Mission propensity. You understand any of this?
No. This looks like a table of temperatures. Who is this from?
It's anonymous. References to PM. It's got to be Philip Morris, huh?
Have to take a shower.
Hi, this is Doug Oliver.
Oh, hi, Doug. It's Lowell.
I'm doing a story on fire safety of people burning up from falling asleep smoking. I receive a shitload of scientific papers from inside Philip Morris.
Anonymous. You or anybody in FDA know someone who can translate this stuff in English for me?
Yeah.
Do we have time?
Mr. Wygant, please?
Someone's calling for Daddy, Mom.
Oh, all right. Thank you, Bob. My name is Lowell Bergman. No, Bergman. B-E-R-G-M-A-N. I'm a producer with 60 Minutes. 60 Minutes? Yeah.
60 Minutes, a television show?
Yes.
He doesn't want to talk to you.
How does he know he doesn't want to talk to me? He doesn't know what I'm calling him about.
He doesn't care to know.
If you'd like to leave a message or send a fax, start now.
This is Lowell Bergman with 60 Minutes, and I'm doing a story on fire safety in cigarettes. I have scientific documents from a tobacco company, and I could use your help as a consultant explaining these documents to me. Now, my number is area code 510-555-0199. I'll be there at this number in 10 minutes.
If you're curious to meet me, I'm going to be in the lobby
of the Seal Bach Hotel in Louisville, reading the New York Times tomorrow at 5 o'clock.
Have you always lived in Louisville?
Mr. Bergman, what did you want me to consult about? Who's that?
That's room service. They usually knock first. Come on in. Over here, please. Thank you. How do you like your coffee? Black?
Black, black. Look, I really don't have that much time.
Is there anything you want to know about me, Mr. Weigand?
Like what? Your sign? I know what I have to know.
Just so I know, you know. When I talk to people in confidence, it stays that way.
How did the radical journalist from Ramparts magazine end up at CBS?
I still do the tough stories. 60 Minutes reaches a lot of people.
Let me see the documents. This is a fire safety product study for Philip Morris. Burn rates, ignition propensity, things of this nature. I could very easily explain this to you in layman's terms because it's from another company. But that's as far as I go.
As far as you go where?
This issue is a drop in the bucket. I can talk to you about what's in here, but I can't talk to you about anything else. I signed a confidentiality agreement. I honor agreements. Doesn't CBS have confidentiality agreements, Mr. Bergman?
Between journalists and management, yes, I believe they do. But I don't take that seriously. Where do you work?
Did work.
Did work.
How much would I get paid?
That you have to discuss with CBS Business Affairs. But for something like this, I would say anywhere between 10,000, 12,000.
Should I just take the documents now?
If you want to do it.
I've worked as a head of research and development for Brenneman Williamson, tobacco company. I was a corporate vice president. Mr. Bergman.
President Assad of Syria said that difficult obstacles remain, but that his country, quote, looks forward to a great long peace with Israel.
It's Peabody, Mike. When you're dead and buried, Hezbollah is the one they're going to remember.
In barracks, lying when he's talking to Sheikh Musa.
Were you eating with us?
Yeah.
Bring a tie so there was some in the front room.
Main justice investigating a major New York bank laundering narco dollars out of their Mexico City branch. You want it for the evening news?
What about you? You got a call ready?
I'm gonna do a follow-up.
Okay.
Catch you later. Debbie.
How are you?
I want you to get legal on a corporate confidentiality agreement. It's boundaries of their constraint. Kentucky state law about once we drop everything.
Okay.
Let me change. You got the change?
I'm here.
Wagon. You can go up now.
Sorry. I'm accepting an award from the Retinitis Pigmentosa Foundation. It's gonna kill the rest of my day. Yeah. So, you had a chance to play golf? Jeff's a premier golfer. What are you, 2 handicap?
7.
And he gets out there and he has 5 strokes on us. He has more concentration than anybody I've ever met. It's spooky how he can concentrate.
I'd rather play than talk about it. What did you want to see me about? I don't like being back here.
Well, Jeffrey says exactly what's on his mind. Most people consider what they're saying, social skills. Jeffrey just charges right ahead. Now, I know you understood the nature of the confidentiality portion of your severance agreement with Brown and Williamson, Jeff.
Chapter and verse.
Yeah, I know you do. You know, I came up through sales. One of the reasons I was a great salesman was I never made a promise I couldn't keep. I knew that if I ever broke my promise, I'd suffer the consequence.
Is that a threat?
We worked together for what was it? 3 years. Now, the work we did here is confidential, not for public scrutiny, any more than I want's family matters.
You're threatening my family now, too?
Now, don't be paranoid, Jeff. About the direction of research here, we may have had our differences of opinion.
Research? You declare as a badge of honor you don't even know what makes water boil.
Well, that's why we hire scientists.
Okay. I don't believe you can maintain corporate integrity without confidentiality agreements. I was paid well for my work. The health and welfare benefits are good. The severance package is fair. I have no intention of violating my confidentiality agreement and disclosing that which I said I wouldn't.
I appreciate all that, Jeff. But upon reflection, we've decided to expand our zone of comfort with you. So we've drafted a supplement to your agreement. It broadly defines and expands in more detail what is confidential. Nobody will be able to say, well, hell's bells, Margaret. I didn't know that was a secret. We're very serious about protecting our interests. We'd like you to sign it.
And if I don't?
If we arrive at the conclusion that you're acting in bad faith, we would terminate right now, payouts under your severance package, you and your family's medical benefits, and initiate litigation against you, Mr. Wygand.
Dr. Wygand.
Dr. Wygand. After you've examined the document, you'll see it's in your own best interest, and you'll sign it.
So what you're saying is it isn't enough that you fired me for no good reason. Now you question my integrity. On top of the humiliation of being fired, you threaten me. You threaten my family. It never crossed my mind not to honor my agreement. I will tell you, Mr. Sandifer, and Brown and Williamson too, fuck me. Well, fuck you.
I'm not sure he got the message.
Oh, I think he did.
Yeah. You fucked me.
Who's this?
Protect your sources. You screwed me. You sold me out.
What are you talking about? Where are you?
Fuck you two. Stay away from me!
This is Wygand.
Something quick, come on.
How do you do? I'm Lowell Bergman. You spoke on the phone. Here, I want to talk to you.
Good, I want to talk to you. This is
I
my
did
house.
Not
in front of my wife,
you,
my kids.
I did not give you up to anyone.
What business do we have?
To straighten something out with you. Right here, right now.
You didn't mention my name. You haven't talked to anybody about
what
me?
Am I
why
am
Brown Williamson? No, I spoke
how
to
how the hell do I know about Brown
Williamson? It happened
Williamson.
Just after I talked to you.
I don't know. What
I do
you
not
mean?
Like coincidence.
Well, I don't like paranoid accusations. I'm a journalist. Think. Use your head. How do I operate as a journalist? By screwing the people who could provide me with information before they provided me with it.
You came all the way down here to tell me that?
No, I did not. Big Tobacco is a big story, and you got something important to say, I can tell. But yes, I did. I came all the way down here to tell you, story, no story. Fuck your story. I don't burn people.
Drive with me while I take the girls to school.
Daughter. And I'm unemployed, so I have to protect my medical coverage. So I left them a message this morning, their expanded confidentiality agreement. I will sign it.
They're afraid of you, aren't they?
They should be.
Well, talk to me outside the zone of your agreement.
Like what?
Like, where'd you work before Brown and Williamson?
Johnson & Johnson, Union Carbide in Japan. I was the general manager and director of new products. I speak Japanese. And I was the director of corporate development at Pfizer. All health-related. What else outside the zone?
I don't know. You think the Knicks are going to make it to the semifinals? Give me an example.
Okay. For example, James Burke, CEO of Johnson & Johnson. When he found out that some lunatic had put poison in Tylenol bottles, he didn't argue with the FDA. He didn't even wait for the FDA to tell him. He just pulled Tylenol off every shelf at every store right across America instantly. And then he developed a safety cap. Because look, as a CEO, sure, he's got to be a great businessman, right? But he's also a man of science. So he's not going to allow his company to put on a shelf a product that might hurt people. Not like the Seven Dwarfs.
Seven Dwarfs?
Seven CEOs of big tobacco. They got him in front of Congress that time. It was on television.
Yeah. Swore under oath that they know nothing about addiction disease.
He's on C-SPAN, yeah.
Okay, so here you are. You go to work for tobacco. You come from corporate cultures where research, really, creative thinking, these are core values. You go to tobacco. Tobacco's a sales culture, market and sell enormous volume, go to a lot of golf tournaments, the hell with everything else. I mean, what are you doing? Why are you working for tobacco in the first place?
I can't talk about it. The work I was supposed to do might have had some positive effect. I don't know. I mean, it could have been beneficial. Mostly, I got paid a lot. I took the money. My wife was happy. My kids have good medical, good schools, got a great house. I mean, what the hell is wrong with that?
Nothing's wrong with that. That's it. You're making money. You're providing for your family. What could be wrong with that?
I always thought of myself as a man of science. That's what's wrong with it.
Then you're in a state of conflict, Jeff. Because look, here's how it lays out. If you got vital insider stuff the American people for their welfare really do need to know and you feel impelled to disclose it and violate your agreement in doing so, that's one thing. On the other hand, if you want to honor this agreement, then that's simple. You do so. You say nothing, you do nothing. There's only one guy who can figure that out for you, and that's you, all by yourself.
Gotta go pick up the girls. I only had half a day.
you believe nicotine is non-addictive?
Congressman, cigarettes and nicotine clearly do not meet the classic definitions of addiction. There is no intoxication.
We'll take that as a no, and again, time is short. I think each of you believe nicotine is not addictive. We just would like to have this for the record.
I believe that nicotine is not addictive.
And I do believe that nicotine...
He referred to this, the seven dwarfs.
What seven dwarfs?
The seven CEO of Big Tobacco referred to this, said they should be afraid of him. I assume afraid of what he could reveal. Now, you tell me, what does this guy have to say that threatens these people?
Well, it isn't cigarettes are bad for you.
Hardly new news?
No shit.
What's this?
What that is tobacco's standard defense. It's the we don't know litany. Addiction? We believe not. Disease? We don't know. We take a bunch of leaves, we roll them together, you smoke them. After that, you're on your own. We don't know. So, that tells me nothing. Besides, you never get what he's got.
Why not?
Because of this guy's confidentiality agreement, he's never going to be able to talk to you.
That's not good enough. This guy is the top scientist. In the number three tobacco company in America, he's a corporate officer. You never get whistleblowers from Fortune 500 companies. This guy is the ultimate insider. He's got something to say. He wants to say it. I want it on 60 Minutes.
Doesn't matter what he wants.
Am I missing something?
What do you mean, Mike?
I mean, he's got a corporate secrecy agreement. Give me a break. Well, this is a public health issue, like an unsafe airframe on a passenger jet or some company dumping cyanide into the East River. Issues like that. He can talk, we can air it. They've got no right to hide behind a corporate agreement. Pass the notes.
They don't need the right. They got the money.
The unlimited checkbook. That's how Big Tobacco wins every time on everything. They spend you to death. $600 million a year in outside legal. Chadburn Park, Ken Starr's firm, Kirkland & Ellis. Listen, GM and Ford, they get nailed after 11 or 12 pickups blow up, right? These clowns have never, I mean ever.
Not even once.
Not even with hundreds of thousands dying each year from an illness related to their product, have ever lost a personal injury lawsuit. On this case, they'll issue gag orders, sue for breach, anticipatory breach, enjoin him, you, us, his pet dog, the dog's veterinarian, tie him up in litigation for 10 or 15 years. I'm telling you, they bat 1,000 every time. He knows that. That's why he's not going to talk to you.
Okay, let's look through the looking glass the other way.
What do you mean?
We got a guy who wants to talk, but he's constrained. What if he were compelled to talk?
Oh, torture. Great rating.
What do you mean, compelled?
I mean, compelled by a Justice Department, state courts, to be a witness. That would cut through any confidentiality agreement, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
What does that do?
What do you mean, what's it do?
What I mean is, like, how does it cut through the confidentiality agreement?
Because he has to reveal it in the court of law. It's on record. It's out. It's no secret anymore. So how can they restrain his speech or retaliate? It's out in the world.
Well, if you could engineer it into the court record, you might have something. I mean, they would have a hell of a time trying to restrain his speech then, wouldn't they?
Yeah, but what venue? And where does he get... I mean, does he have killer attorneys?
I don't think he's got any attorneys.
He's going to need attorneys who aren't afraid of risking years of litigation and millions of dollars of their own dough in legal costs.
What do you say, Mike? What do you think?
Even if he gets the defense team, will he go for it?
You're awfully overqualified, Dr. Wigand.
I'm trying to start a new career. I believe I could be a good teacher.
Let me give it some thought.
And not a lot of companies in the healthcare field hire ex-tobacco scientists. that's it.
That's why our babies were born. Debbie took her first steps right there on... I didn't plan on this.
Hey. Come on. Come on. We can make this work for us, okay? It's a smaller scale. Simpler. Easier. More time. More time together. More time with the kids. More time for us, okay? It's just... You imagine me coming home from some job, feeling good at the end of the day? This is gonna be better. This is gonna be better.
Outside, Daddy.
Did you see somebody or did you hear them?
I heard them.
Where?
In the backyard.
Some paper and draw me a picture, okay? What are you gonna draw me, baby? An animal? Something like that? You stay down here until Daddy gets back, all right, Barbara? You stay down here.
It's just a raccoon, baby. Nothing. They're nocturnal, you know what that means? That means that they only come out at night time.
It's okay.
How's the new place?
New place? New.
You okay?
Sure.
You know, I was thinking of calling you tomorrow anyway. How's your
kids handling the new house?
Good. Have you got kids?
We have a couple.
One's hers, one's mine. Everybody uses a different name. Modern marriage.
How's Leanne?
She's okay. Hold on a minute. No. Somebody may be following me. I don't know.
They came on the property. What do you mean followed?
Did you call the police?
I don't want to be paranoid. I mean,
maybe it's a game. It's some kind of mind game.
Well, what do you really think, though?
I don't know what the fuck I really think, you know? Are they doing it? Is some crank doing it? Are they doing it to make me feel paranoid?
Are they doing it for real? I don't give a shit what I think. I don't know. I don't
fucking know.
Jeffrey,
describe for me in detail what happened.
Well, no, look, I mean, there was a footprint. Forget it, you know?
It's probably not important at all. You know, I got a job now.
I'm teaching high school Japanese and chemistry. What were you calling about?
You called me.
No, you said you were going
to call me tomorrow, so what about?
Oh, yes.
Yes, I did. I wanted to talk to you. I wanted to hook up with you.
Talk to you about what we were talking about in your car.
Okay.
Makes you feel good? Putting what you know to use?
How did you know that, Paul?
It's obvious, isn't it?
Yeah. Look, thanks for talking. I'm sorry I woke you up.
It's okay.
Paul. Who is this?
Do not call here. Do not...
Soreja, shishamoto, tempura teishoku 2つ.
はい、かしこまりました。生牡蠣と shishamoto、tempura teishoku 2つですね。
それとお酒もう一本。
はい。
What are you gonna get us?
Tempura. The internet said you did graduate work at Wisconsin, then went to UC La Jolla with Professor Herbert. Marcus?
Marcuse. Yeah. He was my mentor. He had a major influence on the new left of the late 60s, and on me personally.
Next to your father?
My father? What the hell's that got to do with my father?
is that why you became a journalist? Then you get to ask all the questions?
Are you charged by the hour?
My father was a mechanical engineer. Most ingenious man I ever knew.
Well, my father left us when I was 5 years old. He was not the most ingenious man I ever knew. Let's get back to Brown and Williamson. If you decide to go on 60 Minutes, I got to know everything about why you were fired.
Why?
They're going to dig up stuff from your past. They're going to throw it at you. I got to know what they're going to throw. You understand?
I drink. A couple occasions more than I should have. I was cited for shoplifting once, but it was a mistake. Pushed Leanne one time, and we were both stressed out because of the pressure. She went to her mother's. I got fired because When I get angry, I have difficulty censoring myself, and I don't like to be pushed around.
I'm not pushing you around. I'm asking you questions.
I'm just a commodity to you, aren't I? I could be anything, right? Anything worth putting on between commercials.
To a network, probably we're all commodities. To me, you're not a commodity. What you are is important. You go public and 30 million people hear what you gotta say, nothing, I mean nothing, will ever be the same again. You believe that?
No.
You should. Because when you're done, a judgment is gonna go down in a court of public opinion, my friend. And that's the power you have.
You believe that?
I believe that. Yes, I believe
that. You believe that because you get information out to people, something happens?
Yes.
Maybe that's just what you've been telling yourself all these years to justify having a good job. Having status. And maybe for the audience, it's just voyeurism, something to do on a Sunday night. And maybe it won't change a fucking thing. And people like myself and my family are left hung out to dry, used up, broke, alone.
Are you talking to me, or did somebody else just walk in here? I never saw any of that.
Understand.
No,
exactly.
Don't evade a choice you gotta make by questioning my reputation or 60 Minutes with this cheap skepticism.
I have to put my family's welfare on the line here, my friend. And what are you putting up? You're putting up words.
Words. While you've been dicking around some fucking company golf tournaments, I've been out in the world giving my word and backing it up with action. Now, are you gonna go and do this thing or not?
I said I'd call the kids before they went to bed.
Vanessa.
Stringer was supposed to be shooting B-roll on street cops in New Orleans. What's with all the horses?
Hammer guy's got a thing about mounted police.
Don't any of these guys riding cars? Walk?
How long did he stay?
What was he saying?
Yeah, hello. Yes, I'm trying to reach Mr. Richard Scruggs.
This is Richard Scruggs.
Oh, can you hold on a second, please?
All right.
Lowell. Yeah. Okay,
oh, hello, I'm Lowell Bergman.
Hold on. Mobile approach. This is Lear, November 643, over. Request a flight level of 220 on a heading of 284 degrees, over. Mr. Bergman?
Yes, I'm right here. Could you call me back on a hard line?
All right.
Area code 212-555-0199.
I'll call you then.
What do we do with that?
I don't know.
You filed a lawsuit against tobacco on behalf of the state of Mississippi, did you not?
That's right.
Well, I'm working with someone now who's the former head of research at Brown & Williamson, former corporate officer there.
What's your interest in this, Mr. Bergman?
Well, he may tape an interview with us, and we believe if his testimony showed up in a court record first, it would free him up from his confidentiality agreement and give him some protection.
It could work. If it's public record, it's public record.
Yeah, and he's going to need legal representation.
Well, he sure as hell will.
Has he decided to go public?
Because let me tell you, we've been doing this for 3 years now, and we've worked with a lot of corporate cases involving whistleblowers.
So we know Big Tobacco will do everything in their power to stop him.
So is your man truly committed?
Well, actually, no. Well, he's on the fence, that's the point.
Well, we'd certainly be interested in making his acquaintance, but without knowing what he's going to do.
Well, would you want him to call you, or you want to call him? How do you want to do it?
It would be better if he called us.
Yeah, okay.
All right.
Okay, thank you. Shit. Oh, we need cops on the streets. We don't need them on horses.
I don't know what he was thinking.
Oh, for God's sake. Right. Is this guy got a horse fetish?
All right, all right.
Get me to New Orleans at 7. Shoot the fucking thing myself.
Have a good one.
What are you cooking?
I'm cooking pasta primavera.
Oh, I love that stuff.
I'll go ahead and have to go downstairs.
Dispatch received a call of shots fired in the area, and uniforms arrived on the scene and found this white male subject shot to death.
It was gang related?
There's no indication as far as a tag or an advertisement.
Yeah.
They're terrorizing us. Death threats, my family, my kids.
Whoa, what are you talking about?
Someone put a bullet in my mailbox.
Jeff, call the FBI.
Right away.
They do this with impunity.
Jeff.
They get to go home at night. What does it cost these people to do this to us? Nothing. My girls are crying. So fuck them.
I want a tape. I'm done.
I heard you. I got to arrange for a legal defense first. I got to get you to testify in court. Get it on public record.
Then hold it off the air until you got that. But I want to go to New York, and I want to go on the record. Right now.
Good. But Jeff.
I'll call them, Lowell.
Did you handle the round, Mr. Wigan?
Yes, I'm afraid I did.
We won't be able to lift usable prints. Do you own a gun, Mr. Wigan?
A gun, yes.
What caliber is your gun?
What caliber is my gun?
Yes, sir. What caliber is your gun?
What does that have to do with the price of tea in China?
You think I put the bullet in the mailbox myself?
If we could take a look, Mr. Wigan.
Why do you keep this gun?
I don't think it's unconstitutional yet to own a gun. I'm a target shooter.
That bullet was for a 38 caliber. Do you own a 38?
Yes, I do. A 38 Target Master, my gun safe downstairs, a 45 Gold Cup, a 22 Target pistol. So what?
Do you have a history of emotional problems, Mr. Wigan?
Yes. Yes, I do. Yes. I get extremely emotional when assholes put bullets in my mailbox.
I didn't tell you that, so you could just pick it up and take it away. Jeffrey!
What's going on?
I told him you had an email death threat that said if you didn't shut the F up, they were going to kill you.
Can't take that. It's personal property.
We need to take a look at your gun safe, Mr. Wagon.
Mr.
I'm telling you, your agents in that office are acting improperly. Now, who are they trying to protect?
Let me tell you something, Lo. Look. You're talking about two agents in a regional office in Louisville. I got the goddamn Unabomber threatening to blow up LAX. I gotta move
45 agents from all over the country into LA.
All right, when I get a chance, I'll give it a look.
You better take a good look, because I'm getting
two things: pissed off and curious. Now, any of these guys been offered jobs in corporate security after they retire? Either one of those guys got ex-agent pals already in those jobs. Like, for instance, their ex-supervisor, who's already at Brown and Williamson as we fucking speak.
I'll give it a look.
You're getting my drift.
I'll give it a look.
So is everything okay?
How are the rooms? Comfortable?
Yes, very. Do you know, I enjoy your work so much. When you're talking to somebody, I always feel like I'm right there.
Thank you for saying that.
You think we could talk about the taping, tomorrow's taping, just so we can get it out of the way and in order?
Yeah, well, questions will go toward what work you did there, why you were fired, and others.
Taping? What are you taping?
I'm doing an interview.
An interview? Do you know what they will do to us? I thought we...
Leanne, this is a preliminary... You didn't tell her we were taping? What did she think she was coming to New York for?
Talk about it, think about it. I had a plan to ease her into it, but I don't know how to do that.
Man. Who are these people? Ordinary people under extraordinary pressure, Mike. What the hell do you expect? Grace and consistency?
Mr. Sandifer say, before Congress, that he believed nicotine was not addictive.
I believe Mr. Sandifer perjured himself because I watched those testimonies very carefully.
No, all of us did. I mean, there was this whole line of people, whole line of CEOs up there all swearing.
Part of the reason I'm here is that I felt that their representation clearly misstated, at least within Brown and Williamson's representation, clearly misstated what is common language within the company. We are in the nicotine delivery business.
And that's what cigarettes are for.
Delivery device for nicotine.
A delivery device for nicotine. Put it in your mouth, light it up, and you're going to get your fix.
You're going to get your fix.
You're saying that Brown and Williamson manipulates and adjusts the nicotine fix, not by artificially adding nicotine, but by enhancing the effect of nicotine through the use of chemical elements, such as ammonia.
The process is known as impact boosting. While not spiking nicotine, they clearly manipulate it. There's extensive use of this technology known as ammonia chemistry. It allows for the nicotine to be more rapidly absorbed in the lung and therefore affect the brain and central nervous system. The straw that broke the camel's back for me and really put me in trouble with Sandifer was a compound called coumarin. When I came on board at B&W, they had tried to transition from coumarin to a similar flavor that would give the same taste and had been unsuccessful. I wanted it out immediately. I was told that it would affect sales, so I should mind my own business.
I constructed a memo to Mr. Sandifer indicating I could not in conscience continue with coumarin in a product that we now knew, we had documentation, was similar to coumadin, a lung-specific carcinogen.
And you sent the document forward to Sandifer?
I sent the document forward to Sandifer. I was told that we would continue to work on a substitute. We weren't going to remove it, as it would impact sales, and that that was his decision.
In other words, you were charging Sandifer and Brown and Williamson with ignoring health considerations consciously?
Most certainly.
And on March 24th, Thomas Sandifer, CEO of Brown and Williamson, had you fired. And the reason he gave you?
Poor communication skills.
And you wish you hadn't come forward? You wish you hadn't blown the whistle?
Yeah, there are times I wish I hadn't done it. There are times I feel compelled to do it. If you'd ask me, would I do it again? Do I think it's worth it? Yeah, I think it's worth it.
Jeff Wigand. You can call me Mr. Wigand. You can call me Dr. Wigand. I have a PhD in biochemistry and endocrinology. You can call me Jeff. Anything else you want to call me, you'll have to do so in private. Okay. I find chemistry to be magical. I find it an adventure, an exploration into the building blocks of our physical universe. So how many of you have taken chemistry before? Okay, I've never taught it before, so we're gonna be fine. Our first experiment is gonna be measuring the molecular weight of butane.
He's on line three.
Hello? Mr. Scruggs, Jeff Wigand. Lord Bergman said I should give you a call.
My co-counsel, Ron Motley, and I have filed a lawsuit against the tobacco industry on behalf of the state of Mississippi.
To get the state reimbursed Medicaid costs for treating people with smoking-related illness.
If you'd be interested in talking to us, we'd certainly like to talk to you.
When should we do this?
What are you doing in my house?
It's okay, Jeff.
Mr. Wigand, you need to speak
to
you.
It's okay. You got your own security now.
No, Law, I can't afford to.
No, a volunteer. A friend owns a large security company.
How you doing, Mr. Wigand? I'm John Talaferro. There'll be three of us on detail.
I'm going to the store. Please explain why your house gets to your children.
I called Richard Scruggs in Mississippi.
I heard.
I'm going to be a witness for them in that litigation. So I'm going to fly to Pascagoula to give a deposition.
I know I'm going to go there tonight.
All right. Did you have a good day?
Yes, I did have a great day.
Coffee, Lowell?
Yeah. All right. Want to play that game we played before? You know, I think you got it up to five. I
Please don't wash your hands in the sink.
Where should I wash them?
Use the bathroom.
What's the difference?
That's for food. Leave it on, okay? I don't think I can do this. I want to stand by my husband. I really do, Jeffrey, but I don't think I can do this anymore. I'm so sorry.
Can we talk about this when I get back?
Yes, Jeffrey.
It's okay. It's okay. Jeff. You've been served.
Now, what this one is a temporary restraining order, a gag order, issued by a Kentucky court. Jeff Wygand, Michael Moore.
Good to meet you, Dr. Wygand.
Mike's our attorney general down here. I was just explaining to Jeff, they got a Kentucky court to issue a gag order to stop his deposition today.
Right.
Now, they tried to get the Mississippi court to honor it, but the judge threw it out. However, for you, there is a more perilous effect to the gag order.
Dr. Wygand, you do understand what can happen, don't you?
I'm not free to testify it. Here.
That's right. If you violate the Kentucky order, when you step foot back in Kentucky, they can find you in contempt, and they can incarcerate you. And you ought to know that.
Jail.
Possibly, yes. That is one of the possible consequences of your testifying here today. That's right.
How does one go to jail?
What does my family do? Go on welfare? If my wife has to work, who's gonna look after the kids? Put food on the table. I mean, my children need me. If I'm not teaching, there's no medical. No medical, even on copay, that's like tuition.
Dr. Wargan, listen, you may not be able to do this thing. As I understand from Dick, you are a key witness, and I hope you don't withdraw. I guess we'd all understand if you did. Guys, I gotta go. I'm gonna be late for court. I'll see y'all a little later. Dr. Wagan, good luck. See ya.
I know what you're facing, Jeff. And I think I know how you're feeling. In the Navy, I flew A-6s off carriers. In combat, events have a duration of seconds, sometimes minutes. But what you're going through goes on day in, day out, whether you're ready for it or not. Week in, week out, month after month after month. Whether you're up or whether you're down. You're assaulted psychologically. You're assaulted financially, which is its own special kind of violence because it's directed at your kids. What school can you afford? How will that affect their lives? You're asking yourself, will that limit what they may become? You feel your whole family's future is compromised, held hostage. I do know how it is.
You attract the crowd.
Yeah, great.
I heard about the Kentucky gag order.
I don't know what to do. Can't seem to find the criteria to decide. It's too big a decision to make without being resolved in my own mind.
Maybe things have changed. Since this morning?
No, I mean since whenever. Fuck it. Let's go to court.
Dr. Wagan would like to leave now.
Okay, Jeff, I'm going to sit you down at that table over there. I want to start as fast as possible. I want to give them a chance to get another restraining order, okay? Let's go.
Good luck, Doc.
Please stand. Raise your right hand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
You may be seated.
You understand, Dr. Wagon, you are under oath. This is a sworn deposition. There's no judge. It's not a trial. Will you state your name for the record?
Jeffrey S. Wagon, R-E-Y-W-I-G-A-N-D.
You got any idea what's going on in there?
No, I don't have a clue.
That is correct.
In other words, it acts as a drug.
I object to the form of question.
It acts as a drug on
object
the body.
Object to the form.
It acts as a drug.
Object.
Will you then echo in here? Your objection's been recorded. She typed it into her little machine over there. It's on the record. So now I'll proceed with my deposition of my witness. Does it act
Dr.
as a
Wagon.
Drug?
Dr. Wagon. I am instructing you not to answer that question. In accordance to the terms of the contractual obligations undertaken by you, not to disclose any information about your work at the Brown and Williamson Tobacco Company, and in accordance with the force and effect of the temporary restraining order that has been entered against you by the court in the state of Kentucky. That means you don't talk. Mr. Motley, we have rights here.
Oh, you got rights. And lefts. Ups and downs and middles. So what? You don't get to instruct anything around here. This is not North Carolina, not South Carolina, nor Kentucky. This is the sovereign state of Mississippi's proceeding. Wipe that smirk off your face! Dr. Wagon's deposition will be part of this record. And I'm going to take my witness's testimony, whether the hell you like it or not! Answer the question, Doctor.
Yes, it produces a physiological response, which meets the definition of a drug. Nicotine is associated with impact, satisfaction. It has a pharmacological effect that crosses the blood-brain barrier intact.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you.
Nicotine's not addictive. Run that on camera and cut right to Wygan with, I believe they purge it. Then go wide to the CEO's old technique. Back on Jeff and play the pause after the word felt on the B-side.
Hell of a show, Mike. Explosive material.
Went great in Mississippi, Mike.
Good.
I heard Wygan's deposition got sealed.
Yeah, they argued he was going to reveal the secret formula of cools to the world. Seal doesn't hurt Scruggs' litigation. And since we're the only ones with the story, I believe we're sitting on an exclusive.
I like that.
Corporate has some questions. We've got a meeting at BlackRock first thing in the morning.
When's the air date?
Sharon's on my plate.
Good work.
Tell her I'll call back in 10.
Here we go.
But they had long known that the nicotine in tobacco is an addictive drug, despite their public statements to the contrary. Like the testimony before Congress of Dr. Wygan's former boss, Brown and Williamson's chief executive officer, Thomas Sandifer.
I believe that nicotine is not addictive.
I believe Mr. Sandifer perjured himself because I watched those testimonies very carefully.
Well, all of us did. I mean, there was this whole line of people, a whole line of CEOs up there all swearing.
And part of the reason I'm here is that I felt that their representation clearly misstated what is common language within the company. We are in the nicotine delivery business. There's extensive use of this technology known as ammonia chemistry. It allows for the nicotine to be more rapidly absorbed in the lung and therefore affect the brain and central nervous system.
And that's what cigarettes are for.
Delivery device for nicotine.
A delivery device for nicotine. Put it in your mouth, light it up, and you're going to get your fix.
You're going to get your fix.
Shall I send for coffee? Sorry I'm late.
No, no, we're fine.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
All right. I thought we'd get together because there's a legal concept that has been getting some new attention recently. Tortious interference. If two people have an agreement, like a confidentiality agreement, and one of them breaks it because they are induced to do so by a third party, the third party can be sued for damages for interfering, hence tortious interference.
Interfering? That's what we do.
I think what we're trying to tell you is that it happens all the time. This is a news organization. People are always telling us things they shouldn't. We have to verify if it's true and in the public interest, and if it is, we air it.
And after we corroborate it, that's why we've never lost a lawsuit and run a classy show. Anything else?
And 60 minutes verification is exact and precise, and I don't think it would hurt to make sure you're right on this one.
Why? You think we have liability? What's the CBS News position, Eric?
There's a possibility it's rather remote.
But one we have to check on, Mike. I've retained outside counsel to do exactly that on a segment, I might add, that's already rife with problems.
What does that mean? Rife?
I'm told unusual promises were made to Wiegand.
No, only that we would hold the story until it was safe for
and
him.
And I'm told there are questions as to our star witness's veracity.
His veracity was good enough for the state of Mississippi.
Our standards have to be higher than anyone else's because we are the standard for everybody else.
Well, as a standard, I'll hang with is this guy telling the truth.
Well, with tortious interference, I'm afraid the greater the truth, the greater the damage.
Come again?
They own the information he's disclosing. The truer it is, the greater the damage to them. If he lied, he didn't disclose their information, and the damages are smaller.
Is this Alice in Wonderland?
You said on this one. What about this one?
If this holds up, and it very well may not, Mike, but if it did, and we aired this segment, and CBS was sued by Brown and Williamson, I think we could be at grave risk.
How grave?
Well, at the end of the day, because of your segment, the Brown and Williamson Tobacco Company could own CBS. Oh, you know, I am sorry, but I'm due upstairs.
Is CBS corporate telling CBS News, do not go to air with this story?
You're getting ahead of yourself. We're all in this together. We're all CBS. We'll find out soon. Thank you, gentlemen.
Tortious interference. Sounds like a disease caught by a radio.
Lunch?
Sure.
Don't worry, we call the shots around here.
Debbie, it's me. I want you to check some filings and give me John Wilson's number, bastard. What now?
Cluster's coming over.
Hello, Lowell. Mike. Don. There has been so much soul-searching about this Wiegand. I've decided we should cut an alternate version of the show without his interview.
So what happened to Ms. Caporelli's checking with outside counsel first, all that crap?
That's happening. And hopefully we won't have to use the alternate, but we should have it in the can.
I'm not touching my film.
I'm afraid you are.
No, I'm not.
We're doing this with or without you, Lowell. If you like, I can assign another producer to edit your show.
Since when has the paragon of investigative journalism allowed lawyers to determine the news content on 60 Minutes?
It's an alternate version. So what if we have an alternate version? And I don't think her being cautious is so damned unreasonable.
So now, if you will excuse me, gentlemen, Mr. Rather's been complaining about his chair again.
Before you go, I discovered this. SEC filing, the sale of CBS Corporation to Westinghouse Corporation.
What?
Yeah, I heard rumors.
Not a rumor, it's a sale. If Tisch can unload CBS for $81 a share to Westinghouse and then is suddenly threatened with a multi-billion dollar lawsuit from Brown and Williamson, that could screw up the sale, could it not?
And what are you implying?
I'm not implying, I'm quoting. More vested interests. Persons who will profit from this merger. Ms. Helen Caporelli, General Counsel of CBS News, $3.9 million. Mr. Eric Cluster, President of CBS News, $1.4 million.
Are you suggesting that she and Eric are influenced by money?
No, no, of course they're not influenced by money. They work for free. And you are a volunteer executive producer.
The CBS does not do that. And you're questioning our journalistic integrity.
No, I'm questioning your hearing. You hear reasonable and tortious interference. I hear potential Brown and Williamson lawsuit jeopardizing the sale of CBS to Westinghouse. I hear shut the segment down, cut Wigand loose, obey orders, and fuck off. That's what I hear.
You're exaggerating.
I am? You pay me to go get guys like Wigand, to draw him out, to get him to trust us, to get him to go on television. I do. I deliver him. He sits, he talks. He violates his own fucking confidentiality agreement. And he's only the key witness in the biggest public health reform issue, maybe the biggest, most expensive corporate malfeasance case in U.S. history. And Jeffrey Wigand, who's out on the limb, does he go on television and tell the truth? Yes. Is it newsworthy? Yes. Are we going to air it? Of course not. Why? Because he's not telling the truth. No, because he is telling the truth. That's why we're not going to air it. And the more truth he tells, the worse it gets.
You are a fanatic. An anarchist, you know that? If we can't have a whole show, then I want half a show rather than no show. But oh no, not you. You won't be satisfied unless you're putting the company at risk.
What are you? Are you a businessman or are you a newsman? Because that happens to be what Mike and I and some other people around here do for a living.
Lowell.
Put the corporation at risk? Give me a fucking break.
Lowell.
These people are putting our whole reason for doing what we do on the line.
Lowell.
What?
I'm with Donald.
What's wrong?
They're killing the Wigand interview.
What?
They're pretending it's processed. It's bullshit. It's a poor guy.
What are you and Mike gonna do?
All of this.
Oh, baby. Jeffrey Wigand.
Jeffrey. How are you?
How's the family? Okay?
There is no family.
What do you mean there is no family?
Leanne has filed for divorce.
And so I've moved out. I see the girls a couple of days a week.
Where are you staying now?
Our favorite hotel, honey.
I checked into room 930. Odd choice, huh?
I don't know how to say this, Jeff, except to just say it right out. So I'll say it. They do not want to air it.
What?
B&W may have threatened litigation. CBS is on the block. But you, I mean, I know how you...
No.
Know what?
I do not think that you know for me what it is to walk in my shoes.
For my kids to have seen it. For them to know why I put them through what I did.
The public airing of that, the testament to why I did what I did, you're telling me it's not going to see the light of day.
Jeff...
Wigand?
It hasn't been Mrs. Wagon for some time.
Well, I'm an investigator, and I was wondering if I could ask you a couple of questions about that.
It's 7 months after we were married, we found out that I had multiple sclerosis.
And you had a daughter, Diane, with
you. Well, Tommy Sanford correct? Told me himself. Yes. He's not going to allow Brown and Williamson to be demonized to the American public. So I told Peter Jennings, and I told him.
You had multiple sclerosis. You had a small child to raise.
Mention that part of the executive summary in the chapters, first wife and estrangement of daughter.
I don't know why.
So I tell Pete, I said,
you have to understand that divorce was something that we both wanted.
Total bullshit artist. Well, he's a shoplifter. He's a convicted shoplifter.
What are you going to do?
Well, what do you think I'm going to do? Quit and protest? I'm not going to do that.
You're taking no for an answer?
No, I'm not going to take no for an answer, no.
Then, what are you doing?
I'm staying right here, doing my job, fighting to get my show on the air. You don't like it, hey, I tell you what, fire my ass.
End up in a high-profile lawsuit with Lowell, the First Amendment martyr? I don't think so. Take a look at this. This is a summary of a dossier that's being prepared. He will lie about his whole life. Who's going to believe him about anything he says? The Wall Street Journal is doing a major story, and I think the Post. You backed the wrong horse. The version without the interview is going to air the week after next.
What was that about?
I'll get me why then.
Sure.
Fuck is this?
Fuck! You never told me you were married before, that you had a daughter.
Well, how is that any of your business? That is not something that you people need to know.
Oh, you know what we do or do not need to know. Since when have you become a media expert?
Well, what do you want to do, Lo? Look at my ass, too?
Oh, my God.
Not even on this anymore. What do you care?
Jeff! Wake the fuck up. Everybody is on the line here.
If they catch you in a lie, they can paint everything with that brush. You understand?
Everything you say.
I told the truth.
Everything you say.
And I can't defend you, man, with one hand tied behind my back because you keep from me what they can discover.
And they will discover everything. Believe me.
I was young. I was young. Confused. We didn't handle it the right way.
She sued you for back payments of child support?
She did not sue me. We had a dispute over money. I settled it. She dropped the complaint. Any other questions?
Yes. Did you lie about being on the American judo team in the Olympics?
What?
Some
public relations guy got hold of a tape of an interview where you're saying
you were on the American judo team in the Olympics.
What kind of shit is this? I was not on the team. I sparred with the Olympic team.
Okay.
All right. ABC telemarketing company?
ABC?
ABC telemarketing company.
A can opener. A $39.95 can opener. I canceled payment. It was junk. You ever bounce a check, Lol?
You ever look at another woman's tits?
You ever cheat a little on your taxes? Whose life, if you look at it under a microscope, doesn't have any flaws?
Well, that's the whole point, Jeffrey. That's the whole point. Anyone's, everyone's.
They are going to look under every rock, dig up every flaw, every mistake you've
ever made. They are going to distort and exaggerate
everything you've ever done, man. Don't you understand?
What does this have to do with my testimony?
That's not
what
the point.
What does it have to do with my testimony? I told the truth.
It's not about telling the
truth. True and proven.
That's not the fucking point whether you told the truth or not.
Hello?
I told the truth.
Told the truth.
I gotta teach class. I gotta go. I gotta teach class.
And I gotta refute every fucking accusation made in this report before the Wall Street Journal ones. I am trying to protect you, man.
I hope you improve your batting average.
cutting the interest rate, and I have that great feature on the wine industry in Chile we've been working on.
And what about the piece by Mykelti?
Hello?
It's Lowell.
Are you guys planning to do a piece on a former top executive in Big Tobacco?
You caught me in a news meeting.
Are you not, Charlie?
You bet we are, and I can't talk to you now.
No, we gotta hook up.
Sure, where?
PJ's.
I'll be there.
Yeah, I got it. 500 pages of it. They looked in every corner of this guy's life. From a spousal abuse charge, to shoplifting, to a traffic ticket he got once for running a red light. It's Terry Lenzner's outfit, IGI. Jack, listen to me. Their strategy. Discredit this guy, ruin his reputation in the Wall Street Journal, and then nobody will ever listen to what he's got to say about tobacco.
Hey, he's dead, unless I can get this thing knocked down.
Make it even a little more attractive. I don't know if you're ever gonna get paid.
Is there any truth to any of it?
That's a good question. Is there any truth to any of it? I doubt it.
What's the deadline?
Soon.
Fax me the summary.
That's great, Jack.
Hey.
Hey.
Quiet.
Jim.
Hey, listen, I hear you guys are sitting on something sensational over there.
Really? Hi, John.
That's
good. Hi, baby.
Catch you later.
Okay, take care.
See you tomorrow.
When's your deadline?
Monday.
Push it.
What? Forget it.
It's a smear campaign, Charlie.
It's drawn from a selectively circulated.
Oh, he's been real selective. About as hard to get hold of as the Manhattan phone book.
Well, it's authoritative. And was overwhelmingly documented.
And it's bullshit. And if I'm right, are you going to put the journal's reputation behind a story that's going to blow up in your face?
I'll take a look at what you got. But I'm not moving any deadlines because you say so. Are you all right?
Yeah.
Officer Marachi? Officer Moravchik, how are you? I'm Sandra Sutherland.
How are you doing?
Fine, thank you. I'm doing a background check. Mind if I sit down?
Your Honor, could I have a word with you? You presided in a dispute over support payments.
Jeffrey Wagon? Yeah, I cited him.
CBS is under criticism because the CBS News program 60 Minutes will not be presenting an interview.
What the hell are you doing? Well, what does it look like I'm doing? I'm editing.
No, no, not that. I'm talking about the Associated Press. They got the story that we pulled this interview and they talked to Mike and I. Did you tell them that we were lying?
No, I should have. I told them I disagreed with you, Mike, and Cluster, that this segment is as good as the original. I'm not lying for you. I'm not going to shut up for you. Not on any of it.
Hey, I'm not going to fire you, okay? Take a vacation. Now.
Lowell?
I think I decided to prep the Sunday show. I did 3 minutes on the evening news. You'll want to see it. Where are you going?
I've been banished. In lieu of being fired.
I took off on Tisch. I took off on corporate. They'll know they're not going to see everything on Sunday night.
I don't know. How does that get Wygan on the air?
Do me a favor. Will you spare me? For God's sake, get in the real world. What do you think? I'm going to resign in protest? To force it on the air? The answer is no. I don't plan to spend the end of my days wandering in the wilderness of national public radio. That decision I've already made.
This Sunday, Wallace will broadcast a report on the tobacco industry, including the tough tactics tobacco companies employ to keep a lid on information that might be damaging. Is there information that people should have that they're not going to have because you're not going to broadcast this interview?
Yes.
Today, CBS News President Eric Cluster defended the network's decision not to broadcast key portions of the controversial interview. Mr. Cluster said, quote, the atmosphere is tougher than ever.
Where's the rest?
Dan?
Where the hell's the rest?
Nebraska football fans voiced their criticism.
You cut it! Coming up,
Bernard Goldberg's American.
You cut the guts out of what I said.
It was a time consideration,
Mike. Bullshit! You corporate lackey. Who told you your incompetent little fingers had the requisite skills to edit me? I'm trying to band-aid a situation here, and you're too dim to...
Mike?
Try Mr. Wallace. We work in the same corporation doesn't mean we work in the same profession. Now, what are you going to do now? You're going to finesse me? Lawyer me some more? I've been in this profession 50 fucking years. You and the people you work for are destroying the most respected, the highest rated, the most profitable show on this network.
These are their leads, their sources. I want you to have your reporters,
Sun Wang and Milo Geiler.
Have them make their own calls. They'll find that these sources have a different story than the one that's in the dossier. Push the deadline, Charlie.
I'll push it for a week. Let Milo and Sue and go through it.
What do you want to buy him for a gift?
These are two kind of little cars that,
That remote control thing?
Yeah.
All right, we'll go do that tomorrow.
The 63-36 vote was three shy of the two-thirds majority needed to pass the constitution.
Mom.
Yes, ma'am.
There's Dad on TV.
Dating back to 1986. The most recent trouble for Wigan occurred here. And in local news, WLKO Louisville has gained access to a 500-page dossier on former Brown and Williamson research head Jeffrey Wigan, detailing charges of shoplifting and failing to pay child support. Wigan is currently teaching chemistry and Japanese at the DuPont Manual High School. Maria?
Thousands of documents from inside the tobacco industry have surfaced over the past year. Documents that appear to confirm what a former U.S. Surgeon General and the current head of the Food and Drug Administration have been saying. We learned of a tobacco insider who could tell us whether or not the tobacco industry has been leveling with the public. That insider was formerly a highly placed executive with a tobacco company. But we cannot broadcast what critical information about tobacco, addiction, and public health he might be able to offer. Why? Because he had to sign a confidentiality agreement with the tobacco company he worked for. The management of CBS has told us that knowing he had that agreement, if we were to broadcast an interview with him, CBS could be faced with a multi-billion dollar lawsuit. The fact is, we are not allowed even to mention his name or the name of the company he worked for. And of course, we cannot show you his face. And your confidentiality agreement with is still in force?
Yes, it is.
So what are they going to do? Sue you for making this appearance?
I would bet on it.
The former executive has reason to bet on being sued for major cigarette manufacturers.
Yeah.
You disappeared on me. How long are you staying?
I disappeared on you.
All right, what did you think?
I think it was a disgrace. All right, get me the manager's office.
but you've got a call on line four. I think you better take it.
David McDougall, how can I help you?
Mr. McDougall,
my name is Lowell Bergman. I'm a producer for 60 Minutes. I'm concerned with a friend of mine who's staying at your hotel right now.
Mr. Wiegand? Mr. Wiegand? I think I need to call the police. He won't respond.
No, no, don't call the police. Now, just tell him I'm on the phone with you. My name is Lowell Bergman. Just tell him that.
Mr. Wiegand, Mr. Bergman is on the telephone.
Did he hear you?
You're breaking up. I can't hear you.
What about now?
What?
Hello? You hear me now?
To get on the fucking phone!
You manipulated me into this.
That's bullshit, Jeff.
You greased the rails.
I greased the rails for a guy who wanted to say yes. I helped him to say yes, that's all. You're not a robot, Jeff. Right? You got a mind of your own, don't you?
Up to you, Jeffrey. That's the power you have, Jeffrey. Vital insider information the American public need to know. Lowell Bergman, the hotshot who never met a source he couldn't turn around.
I fought for you, and I still fight for you.
You fought for me? You manipulated me.
Into where I am now. Staring at the Brown and Williamson building. It's all dark except the 10th floor.
That's the legal department. That's where they fuck with my life.
Jeffrey, where are you going with this?
So,
where you going?
You are important to a lot of people, Jeffrey. You think about that.
You think about them.
I'm running out of heroes, man.
Guys like you are in short supply.
Yeah, guys like you too. Where are you anyway?
I'm on
a leave of absence. Forced vacation.
Will you try and have a good time?
Yeah. Yeah, I will.
I'm Lowell Bergman. I'm from 60 Minutes. You know, you take the 60 Minutes out of that sentence, nobody returns your phone call. Maybe Wiegand's right. Maybe I'm hooked. What am I hooked on? Rush? 60 Minutes? What the hell for? Infotainment! It's so fucking useless, all of it.
So it's a big country with a free press. You can go work somewhere else.
Free press? Press is free. or anyone who owns one. Larry Tisch has a free press.
Get some perspective, Lord.
I got perspective.
No, you do not.
From my perspective, what's been going on and what I've been doing is ridiculous. It's half measures.
You're not listening. Really know what you're going to do before you do it.
I've got Richard Scruggs on the phone.
Patch him through.
Well, Lowell, you are not going to believe this. The governor of Mississippi is suing his own attorney general to abandon litigation against Big Tobacco.
Oh, good.
But now that the version without Jeff ran, what's the chance of getting his interview on the air? Hello?
Yeah, I'm here.
Chances there of getting Jeff's interview on the air?
Less than great.
I'd be lying to you if I did not tell you how important it was in the court of public opinion.
And I'd be lying to you if I didn't tell you I'm about out of moves, Dick.
All right, see ya.
So, what are you folks doing here in Lincoln?
Geology survey.
Geology? Yeah? Really?
How about you?
I work for CBS News.
Oh, yeah?
Just ran into two of your geologists. Geologists whose hands aren't all chewed up.
Low.
Do not screw this up. We are a week away from an arrest.
So, I'll hold it.
And?
We'll give you a heads up before we launch.
How long?
3 hours.
You get a deal.
Like the testimony before Congress of Dr. Wigand's former boss, Brown and Williamson's chief executive officer, Thomas Sandifer.
I believe that nicotine is not addictive.
I believe Mr. Sandifer perjured himself because I watched those testimonies very carefully.
No, all of us did. And there was this whole line of people, whole line of CEOs up there, all swearing.
Part of the reason I'm here is that I felt that their representation.
Central nervous system.
Jeff's room.
Hey, where are you?
Remember that night at PJ's?
You asked me if we were sitting on something explosive. Well, we're not sitting there. CBS Corporate leaned on CBS News, which yanked an interview we did with a top-ranking tobacco scientist, corporate officer. They're trying to close down the story.
You mean 60 Minutes is letting CBS Corporate decide what is or is not news? What's Wallace think about this, or Hewitt? Or...
How prominent, what kind of placement?
Oh, come on. Oh, this is the New York Times. I don't know.
Well, until you do, all I can tell you is what you already know.
They will not air an interview.
Call me back in town.
Hello?
Debbie, it's me.
Hi. What time is it?
Oh, it's late.
I'm glad I know. When are you coming back?
I can't get out of here till mid-morning. I'll be in tomorrow night. Listen, could you call a number for me? It's in Mississippi.
Okay, hold on a second. What is it?
Hello?
Lowell.
All right, Lowell. Page one. Editorial's interested. Let's talk.
Here's how it works.
You ask me questions, I tell you if you're wrong.
Lowell?
Yeah.
You sure you want to do this?
Why?
Hey, it doesn't work. You burn your bridges, man.
You ready?
Okay. About this whistleblower. Did Mike and Don go along with the corporate decision? Lowell?
Did I tell you you were wrong?
No. I'm assuming the cave-in begins with the threat of litigation from Big Tobacco. Are we talking Brown and Williamson here?
No, I usually sit around my hotel room just like this at 5:30 in the morning. Sleepy look on my face.
How many shows have we done? Huh? Come on.
How many? Oh, lots.
Yeah, that's right.
But in all that time, Mike, did you ever get off a plane, walk into a room, and find that a source for a story changed his mind? Lost his heart? Walked out on us, not one fucking time. You wanna know why?
I see a rhetorical question on the horizon.
I'm gonna tell you why. Because when I tell someone I'm gonna do something, I deliver.
Oh, how fortunate I am to have Lowell Bergman's moral tutelage to point me down the shining path to show me the way.
Mike.
Give me a break.
No, you give me a break. I never left a source hung out to dry, ever. Abandoned. Not till right fucking now. When I came on this job, I came with my word intact. I'm gonna leave with my word intact. Fuck the rules of the game. Hell, you're supposed to know me, Mike. What the hell did you expect? You expect me to lie down? Back off? What, get over it?
In the real world, when you get to where I am, there are other considerations.
Like what? Corporate responsibility? Well, are we talking celebrity here?
I'm not talking celebrity. Vanity, CBS. I'm talking about when you're nearer the end of your life than the beginning. And what do you think about them? The future? In the future, I'm going to do this, become that? What future? No. What you think is, how will I be regarded in the end? After I'm gone. Oh, along the way, I suppose I made some minor impact. Did Iran Gate and the Ayatollah, Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, Saddam, Sadat, etc., etc. I showed them thieves in suits. I spent a lifetime building all that. But history only remembers most what you did last. And should that be fronting a segment that allowed a tobacco giant to crash this network
Does it give someone at my time of life pause? Yeah. Mike, in my, you and I have been doing this together for 14 years. This is today's New York Times. In it is the whole sordid story of what went on inside our shop. And in the editorial, it accuses us of betraying the legacy of Edward R. Murrow.
They conclude most of it seems pretty unsubstantiated.
Yeah.
Front page, there's a picture of Wygand. Articles entitled Getting Personal, byline to Suen Wang and Milo Gailin.
Wait, hold on a second, Lol.
Yeah. Yeah, sure, I'll see if I can find them. Hold on. Yeah, Don's looking for you.
Good.
The subheading is Brown and Williamson has a 500-page dossier attacking Chief Critic. It quotes Richard Scruggs calling it the worst kind of an organized smear campaign against a whistleblower. A close look of the file and independent research by this newspaper into its key claim indicates that many of the serious allegations against Mr. Wygand are backed by scant or contradictory evidence.
In the New York Times, in print, on television, for caving to corporate interests.
The New York Times ran a blow-by-blow of what we talked about behind closed doors. You fucked us.
No, you fucked you. Don't invert stuff. Big Tobacco tried to smear Wygand. You bought it. The Wall Street Journal, here, not exactly a bastion of anti-capitalist sentiment, refutes Big Tobacco's smear campaign as the lowest form of character assassination. And now, even now, when every word of what Wygand has said on our show is printed, the entire deposition of his testimony in a court of law in the state of Mississippi, the cat totally out of the bag, you're still standing here debating. Don, what the hell else do you need?
Mike, you tell him.
You fucked up, Don.
It's old news. Stick with me, like always. We'll be okay. These things have a half-life of 15 minutes.
No, that's fame. Fame has a 15-minute half-life. Infamy lasts a little longer. We caved. It's foolish. It's simply dead wrong. Now, this is what we're going to do. We're going over to BlackRock.
Okay, so let's get back to it. All right, now, what we saw there. Two. Potassium chlorate would yield become 2 potassium chlorate. It's also solid.
They canceled at 6 o'clock. I don't know why. I'm on the 810. I should be home 9:30. I'll see you then. I love you.
Thank you.
CBS management wouldn't let us broadcast our original story and our interview with Jeffrey Wigand because they were worried about the possibility of a multi-billion dollar lawsuit against us for tortious interference. But now things have changed. What Dr. Wigand told us was that his former colleague...
Biggest fraud on the American public in history. They killed me.
I wish you hadn't blown the whistle.
Yeah, there are times I wish I hadn't done it. There are times I feel compelled to do it. If you ask me, would I do it again? Do I think it's worth it? Yeah, I think it's worth it.
I promised you a 3-hour heads up. Here it is. Have a camera crew standing by in Helena, Montana on Tuesday. I'll give you a 3-hour head start. All right? By the way, that was a hell of a good show tonight.
Well, thank you, Bill.
Yeah.
Reporting from CBS News World Headquarters in New York, good afternoon. There has been a major break in the case of the so-called Unabomber. CBS News has learned that a remote home site outside of Lincoln, Montana has been under FBI surveillance for several weeks.
Great.
Three people, including 23 others, occurred earlier this month.
Thanks for this. You know, we beat everybody. ABC, NBC, CNN.
That Canada story. Still interests you?
Everything interests me. I quit, Mike.
Come on. It all worked out. You came out okay in the end.
I did. What do I tell a source on the next tough story? Hang in with us, you'll be fine, maybe. No. What got broken here doesn't go back together again.